Good day. Thank you for joining me for today's video. Today we're going to talk a little bit about some of the technology that Grand Seiko has implemented on their divers watches. If you see on the screen, this technology applies to the SBGA 231 and the SBGA 229. And the earlier versions of the same watches, the SBGA 031 and SBGA 029. We're also going to talk about how similar technology applies to the Grand Seiko quartz dive watches models SBGX 335, 337, 339, 115, and 117. So all of the Grand Seiko dive watches. In another video, I'll show some photos of how this technology is used in the Grand Seiko high beat diver and probably also the new 5-day spring drive professional diver. So with that intro, what I'm going to do, if you see here in Grand Seiko's description, and this again is on this page, you'll see that it says that the watch is designed for use in some of the most unforgiving environments, and the rotating bezel is removable for simple maintenance while the area around the crown has been crafted to ensure that residue from dirt, sand, or seawater can be easily washed off. We're actually going to talk about the technology. It is this part. It says the rotating bezel is removable for simple maintenance. So the way I discovered this is, one, I was curious what that meant, and so I hunted down some patent applications and found out exactly what this means, and we're going to talk about exactly what those patent applications show. Here is the Grand Seiko SBGX 335. This is the quartz-style watch. It's appeared on my YouTube page many times. It's one of my favorite in my collection. This page doesn't say the watch has the same technology, but I assure you it does. And so before I cross over to some other images that I have cut and pasted from the patent application, let me show you a quick snap. So if you see this watch right here, sort of looks like the SBGA 231 and 229, right? This would be the spring drive diver's watch. Well, this page appears in their patent application, and I've just cut it out so that I can use it easily without all the other text. And what we're going to do is we're going to talk about this image right here, and I have some better examples of this that I can show you soon. So let me zoom over to those images and we'll get started. Okay, we're back. So what you see on the screen is a schematic that appeared in a patent application filed by Grand Seiko or Seiko Epson. And the case that you see here is the same case as the SBGA 229 and 231 divers watches, which is the same as the 029 and the 031 divers watches. Basically, this is the spring drive 200 meter divers watch case. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to ink this document so that I can show you exactly what I'm looking at. So I'm going to use light blue to identify the parts of the watch, and then we'll use a different color to identify sort of how they work together. So this number right here, one, this is the bezel insert. And this item right here that you see underneath the little blue, that's a crush gasket. And then the next item that you see, I'm going to mark it two, it's right here. This is a threaded collar. You would not see this collar from the outside of the watch. In fact, you'd have to disassemble the watch to see it. But what that threaded collar does is it threads on top of the crystal flange, and we'll show you that in a moment. And then this item number three is actually the steel or the titanium bezel ring. This is the part that has the knurls and the grooves that you would use with your fingers and has the tactile click, and you rotate it. And then lastly, number four here, this is the watch case. And of course, I guess for the sake of comprehensiveness, number five is the case back, right? So the display on the left side of the screen is the same stuff, is the same components, but they've been all fitted together. And so since we're going to look at the sort of the blowout schematic, we'll just keep to the right side of the screen for now. So like I said, number one is the bezel insert. Number two is a threaded collar that it actually is hidden underneath the bezel insert. Number three here is a the bezel ring that you would hold with your fingers and rotate. Number four is the case. So let me show kind of how the parts fit together and why they're kind of cool. So let's use red. So when Seiko says that the bezel is easily disassemblable, what they're really saying is that the bezel can be removed without it being sort of friction fit on the case. And the way that works is if you were to take the bezel insert right here at number one and pry it off, because right here in red it is a crush gasket, the same kind of gasket, in fact, that would hold a crystal in place, just a hydraulic, think of like a nylon thin ring that squeezes between the bezel insert and this surface of the bezel ring itself. So you see those go together. What that does is it conceals this threaded ring right here. You see these threads right here? Those threaded rings. Those rings actually mate to this surface right here. You see here? And so kind of why is that interesting, or why is that important? Well, the idea is that if you assemble the watch so that this metal insert, the metal bezel ring number three is held captive and is sort of tightly affixed to the top of the case, because this threaded collar right here, this part right here, is threaded down right here, if you see where the arrows are, it allows this part to, I guess, be a little bit more reliable, perhaps, or it allows the design to ensure that the bezel ring will not pop off, or probably even get locked or frozen in place if it gets a lot of sand or sediment or clay or silt stuck underneath the bezel. Because obviously these parts have to rotate freely and click. So by having this threaded collar that appears right here, number two, that holds and it sort of applies a clamping force down onto part three, so it clamps part three to the top of part four, you're better able to stabilize that rotating bezel ring and protect it from sediment that might force it off or cause it to kind of pop off, you know, if it's subjected to shock. You know, and I know this concept of like protecting things from shock is very fundamental to Seiko and Grand Seiko's dive watch philosophy and their sort of the design ethos. Hence the reason they use ceramic for shrouds, hence the reason they have a shrouded diver altogether. That kind of philosophy of protecting it from, you know, striking against an object is sort of permeates their ethos. So what this, like I said, just to sort of summarize, the beauty of this design is that this bezel ring won't come off if subjected to shock, because underneath it, concealed cleanly under the bezel insert, is this threaded ring. So you see the parts kind of close together down here. So these are the threads. This is the threaded ring. It clamps down, this threaded ring right here clamps down, and it holds the bezel ring in place. And then on top of that, you press in the bezel insert, which then conceals the threaded ring. And what's interesting about this design, and we're going to contrast this in a moment, you'll note here that this flange right here that I'm drawing a line on, where the crystal mounts, it is unitary to the case by part of the same watch. So that even if you take off the bezel and you do not put it back on, even if you remove this threaded ring and you do not affix it, obviously it would look silly and it would be unbefitting of a Grand Seiko, but if you did, the crystal will stay into place. Okay, so now let me switch over to the next display to talk about how the same technology is applied in the quartz dive watches. Okay, so this is the first screen that I pulled from the patent application for the quartz dive watches from Grand Seiko. So if you look down here, We use blue to start with.
If you see this one right here, this kind of looks like
SBGX 117. Let's see. SBGX 115. 117. It looks like these watches, but it also, the same technology applies in the SBGX 335, 337, and 339. The only difference is sort of design-wise or style-wise how the watches look. A couple things to note on this first diagram. Do you see all so this is threaded. This may be as well. Okay, so let me label these parts quickly, and then we'll start talking, and I'll switch over to another. So this is going to be one. This is the bezel ring. See that? That's the grip you'd hold. This part right here, we're going to call it two, and this is the crystal flange, and it doubles as the threaded ring that holds the crystal both in place and the bezel in place. And then three, here is the bezel insert, and then four, the case body. We're going to swap over to another image real quick, and then I will walk you through how the design works and how they fit together. Okay, so let me go back and number these parts again so that we're clear. So we've got number one, here's the case, and we've got number, I hope the numbering is the same from the prior slide. Number two here is the bezel ring. Three is the bezel, is that this flange, this sort of retaining ring underneath the bezel insert. And then four is the bezel insert. So as I walk through these parts, I'm going to kind of relate them to what we just looked at for the spring drive dive watches. So the first thing to note is that this little gasket, that little gray thing right there, that is a crush gasket. It means it's made of like a plastic material, a hard plastic, often called hytrel. Kind of think of it like Teflon or nylon. Basically what it does is it's compressed in a space between a bezel flange and a like a crystal or another one, and it squeezes to fill the space, and it sort of holds the crystal or the bezel in by friction. Obviously, this is the bezel ring. This is the bezel insert. And so the bezel insert is actually held into place by that little gasket. And the bezel insert actually fits into this profile right here of the bezel ring. Well, the bezel ring is then clamped to the top surface of the case, which is this right here, by this very complicated looking ring. So if you see this interesting profile, a couple of things that are unique about this. One is that on the Grand Seiko quartz dive watches, the crystal, which is this right here, is actually held in place in this threaded ring, unlike in the spring drive divers, where the crystal actually mounts into a piece unitary to the top of the case. Here, the case is more of a true three-piece case, sort of like a true oyster case. Rolexes they don't use threaded components, but they're three-piece watch cases, often not known. And so what happens in this formulation of the technology is that, you know, this is the mid-case, and right here you see these threaded surfaces right here. Do you see that? So those threaded surfaces right there made up with this. And you can see them go through there. And so what would happen is the watchmaker would press the crystal into this flange, this ring, threaded ring, and then he would lay the crystal, the bezel ring on top of the case with the click spring right here. Click spring would be here. And then he would use the flange that holds the crystal in place. It would also thread down onto the case. And here's a gasket, like a waterproof gasket. And that threaded ring would actually clamp down right in this area on top of this part of the bezel ring. And it would hold it into place. So then you would snap the bezel insert right here down on top of it in this profile. Why is that important? Well, I mean, I think the idea, like I've said, is that Grand Seiko and Seiko, they sort of pride themselves on how sort of tough or utilitarian the watches are. And this interesting design sort of means that if you were to subject the bezel to great shock, it very likely would not separate from the watch. So, you know, like I think it's common to know that like some of the 7S26 divers, like the Samurai or the Sumo or the SKX007, those watches have a bezel ring that just is pried off with a case knife. That's just not the case here. And with these Grand Seiko dive watches, if you were to try to pry off the bezel with a case knife, you would either be unsuccessful or you would cause damage to the watch. So, you know, if anyone's listening, it's probably good to kind of make a mental note of that, because you would essentially be trying to pop off a bezel that's not held on by like a spring tension. In fact, because it's held on by this, threaded ring, you know, this threaded part, and it holds the bezel ring in place. I think that's a kind of a neat idea from Grand Seiko to put these pieces together like this. You know, in my mind, this is a much more complex design, and it means that the bezel's probably a little bit more stable, and it probably allows Grand Seiko to fine-tune sort of the tactile feel of the bezels, because there's this ring that threads onto place and holds it, may enable them to create a higher tolerance, perhaps, and maybe that's why the bezel on the spring drive and 9F dive watches feels so premium. But needless to say, it's a very, very interesting design. It also shows, for those of you who are sort of fanatics about the 9F quartz dive watches, this actually shows also how the movement is installed in the case. Because if you see right here, clearly you can see the movement. This is probably the dial plate. The movement is installed this way, and the movement basically fills this space right here. And this part of the case right here prevents it from falling out. But you also see that there's, of course, a thick threaded case back, which you would use to access the battery, to replace the battery or to service parts of the watch, perhaps. But this is kind of how the watch is front loading. That's probably what I should have said to begin with. This design on the quartz models means the watch is front loading, because the crystal goes in after the whole watch and everything has been assembled through the front, even though there's a case back. So that's my video. Hopefully I've kept this video to probably 10 minutes or less. Please like and subscribe. I try to post new content on Fridays. Also, it'd be great to know your thoughts on if you like this kind of content. It certainly is a bit of a difference from what I usually post, but I thought this sharing this kind of technology and these interesting perspectives might sort of appeal to the tech geek or the true watch enthusiast out there. I'm always willing to take suggestions and constructive criticism. It'd also be nice to know if there's some other technology that you're aware of that you think would be worthy of a short video from sort of like a someone like me to explain it, if you think that would be of interest and worthy of your time. Again, thank you so much for joining me. Please like and subscribe, and look for more videos on Fridays. Good day.